A blessed and pleasant good morning, everyone. Welcome to morning prayer for this morning, today being September the 11th in 2020. I apologize for the late start. I had everything set up from 5:30 this morning, went and got ready to make sure I have a face that is presentable unto you. Came back and the computer was completely frozen at 6:05. Figured I had enough time to restart the thing, which I did, and then it just wouldn't work. But praise God, it is here and we are on the air and ready to go. We're going to start this morning with the hymn, Morning Has Broken. Let's have a listen.
Morning has broken. First morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. The rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the red garden, sprung in completeness where we see. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new. First morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from.
I do enjoy me some guitar music, and Cat Williams is one of those guitarists that I enjoy a great deal. Let's get our words here up on screen. I hope you are still seeing. My little monitor says that it's having trouble playing the video, but I do hope you are seeing it on your end. At any rate, I will keep going and recording, and that way we will still have the recording that I could post afterwards. On screen, we should have the words there for morning prayer for September 11th. And of course, today, as we go through our morning prayer, we remember that fateful day years ago when we heard about the terrorist attacks on New York and on the various places in America. And we continue to keep those families in our prayer even to this day. We continue with our opening sentence then. The hour is coming and now is when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for such the Father seeks to worship him. Words from John chapter 4, verse 23. Using versicle 1, which can be found on page 34. Blessed be the Lord our God, by whose grace we are yet alive. Blessed be his Son, Jesus Christ, by whose rising we are set free. Blessed be the Spirit of God, in whom is our hope and our joy. Our invitatory prayer. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. Our first canticle for this morning is the Canticle de Jubilate on page 37 of our Books of Common Prayer, based on Psalm 100. O shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever and his faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. At this time we pause to call to mind before Almighty God those things that in thought, word, or deed we would have committed that would have been offending to him, that would have been unjust to our neighbors, or that would have been unfair to our very selves. For those times and those moments, Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Together we pray. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Psalms for this morning are Psalm 40 and Psalm 54, and it will be read for us by Miss Antoinette Coleman. Let's have a listen.
Today's reading is Psalms 40 and 54. I waited patiently upon the Lord. He stooped to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the desolate pit, out of the mire and clay. He set my feet upon a high cliff and made my footing sure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many shall see and stand in awe and put their trust in the Lord. Happy are they who trust in the Lord. They do not resort to evil spirits or turn to false gods. Great things are they that you have done, O Lord my God. How great your wonders and your plans for us. There is none who can be compared with you. Oh, that I could make them know and tell them, but they are more than I can count. In sacrifice and offering, you take no pleasure. You have given me ears to hear you. Burnt offering and sin offering, you have not required. And so I said, behold, I come. In the roll of the book, it is written concerning me. I love to do your will, O my God. Your law is deep in my heart. I proclaim righteousness in the great congregation. Behold, I did not restrain my lips, and that, O Lord, you know. Your righteousness have I not hidden in my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your deliverance. I have not concealed your love and faithfulness from the great congregation. You are the Lord. Do not withhold your compassion from me. Let your love and your faithfulness keep me safe forever. For innumerable troubles have crowded upon me. My sins have overtaken me and I cannot see. They are more in number than the hairs of my head, and my heart fails me. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me. O Lord, make haste to help me. Let them be ashamed and altogether dismayed who seek after my life to destroy it. Let them draw back and be disgraced who take pleasure in my misfortune. Let those who say, aha, and gloat over me be confounded because they are ashamed. Let all who seek you rejoice in you and be glad. Let those who love your salvation continually say, great is the Lord. Though I am poor and afflicted, the Lord will have regard for me. You are my helper and my deliverer. Do not tarry, O my God. Psalms 54. Save me, O God, by your name. In your might, defend my cause. Hear my prayer, O God. Give ear to the words of my mouth. For the arrogant have risen up against me, and the ruthless have sought my life. Those who have no regard for God. Behold, God is my helper. It is the Lord who sustains my life. Render evil to those who spy on me. In your faithfulness, destroy them. I will offer you a freewill sacrifice and praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. For you have rescued me from every trouble, and my eyes have seen the ruin of my foes. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and forever will be. Amen. Amen.
We want to thank you, Miss Antoinette, for leading us in the Psalms for this morning. We continue then with Canticle number 10, the second song of Isaiah, based on Isaiah 55, verses 6 through to 11. Seek the Lord while he wills to be found. Call upon him when he draws near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the evil ones their thoughts. And let them turn to the Lord, and he will have compassion. And to our God, for he will richly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as rain and snow fall from the heavens and return not again, but water the earth, bringing forth life and giving growth, seed for sowing and bread for eating, so is my word that goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish that which I have purposed and prosper in that for which I sent it. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Old Testament lesson for this morning is from Job chapter 29, verse 1, and then chapter 31, verses 24 to 40. And it reads, Job again took up his disclosure and said, if I have made gold my trust or called fine gold my confidence, if I have rejoiced because my wealth was great or because my hands had acquired much, if I have looked at the sun when it shone or the moon moving in splendor, and my heart has been secretly enticed, and my mouth has kissed my hand, this also would be an iniquity to be punished by the judges, for I should have been false to God above. If I have rejoiced at the ruin of those who hated me, or exulted when evil overtook them, I have not let my mouth sin by asking for their lives with a curse. If those of my tent ever said, oh, that we might be sated with his flesh, the stranger has not lodged in the street. I have opened my doors to the traveler. If I have concealed my transgressions, as others do, by hiding my iniquity in my bosom, because I stood in great fear of the multitude, and the contempt of families terrified me, so that I kept silence, and do not go out of doors. Oh, that I had one to hear me. Here is my signature. Let the Almighty answer me. Oh, that I had the indictment written by my adversary. Surely I would carry it on my shoulder. I would bind it on me like a crown. I would give him an account of all my steps. Like a prince, I would approach him. If my land has cried out against me, and its furrows have wept together, if I have eaten its yield without payment and caused the death of its owners, let thorns grow instead of wheat, and foul weeds instead of barley. The words of Job are ended. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. If you give me a minute to get back to the beginning of the reading from Job here, we will continue our look at the book of Job, and we're looking at chapter 31, verse 24 to 40. Yesterday, we would have looked at verses 1 through to 24, and what an interesting portion of scripture. And today's portion of scripture ends with the words, "The words of Job is ended." And it's not because the book of Job is finished per se, but it's because at this point in the reading, what would have happened is Job would have stopped putting forth his arguments. So remember that the way the thing was set up is that Job gave his speech. His three friends gave their speeches, and after each of their speeches, Job would have rebutted. And then at the end of the third speech, Job rebuts. And this is the ending of the third speech. And while we would have heard from Elihu before we went back to these chapters, it's at the end of this particular portion where no one of his three friends decided to answer him that Elihu began to speak. But before Job ends his declaration of innocence, he continues to maintain that he has not done anything to deserve the calamity that has befallen him. Job was not a greedy person or a seeker of false God. And he says that for us in verse 24 here, when he tells us that if he had made gold his trust or called fine gold his confidence, then if he would have rejoiced in wealth, he would have done something that would have been displeasing to God. Yesterday, we heard him proclaim the goodness of his relationship with God. We heard him proclaim the goodness of his relationship with others. And we heard him reminiscing about how well he would have treated people around him. And today, it's like he's checking off all along. He's been checking off the possibility of things that would have caused him to sin. And in reminiscing over these things, he is showing that, you know what? When I think about these things, I have not committed any of these errors in order to be facing the challenges I am facing. And he's here now at the ending of all of it saying, not even did I come close to worshiping false gods or placing anything before God. And not only that, but I have been faithful in ensuring that people who are all created by God are well taken care of. There was no iniquity in me to be punished by anybody. None whatsoever. And I don't understand why I am going through these things. I have not let my mouth sin by asking for the life of another when they wronged me. I have allowed strangers to come into my house as opposed to having them sleep on the street. I have opened my doors to those who were traveling. I have not hidden my transgressions from anybody. When I did wrong, I admitted that I did wrong. I offered sacrifice for myself and for my children who possibly would have done wrong. And Job is just simply, he's stating his case. He's bearing his everything in order to show those who have accused him of needing to repent of something that there is literally nothing he needs to repent of. He was generally without blame. He claims that he had not taken delight in the suffering of his enemies even. And certainly, if we listen to what Job has to say, he's clearly a man that is marked after God's heart. He's a man after God's own heart. And it's brilliant. And the way he lived his life before his calamity is what we would have expected. Pardon me. Is what we would have expected of any godly man. Hospitality, righteousness. I mean, not just acting as if though I am righteous, but actually being righteous, committed to his family and his wife, faithful to his God in worship, respectable in his community. This guy, Job, was next to perfect. I mean, I was tempted to say Job's surname must have been Rosado. I was tempted to say that, you know what I mean? He's not perfect, but he's pretty doggone close. And it's interesting because Job still feels in all of this testimony, he concludes his plea and demands an audience with God because it has to be you, God. You have to be the one, and you could be the only one that could accuse me of anything, because there has to be something that if I am guilty, I am not seeing. And you who are the seer of things in secret, you have to know. So come and reason with me that you could show me where I have gone wrong. And it seems that Job interprets his defense of his morality and the righteousness of his life in such a way that he is convinced that he needs to be vindicated. And a part of his vindication is being told by God himself where he went wrong. Because he is convinced that there is no human on the face of the earth that could come and find a fault in what he has done. And he's not even convinced of that in arrogance. He is convinced of that with just pure conviction of the fact that he knew how he was living his life for God. And he's convinced that his persecutor is God, when the truth is that his persecutor is Satan. And it shows us there, I think, between verse 35 and 37. Yeah. Oh, that I had one to hear me. Let the Almighty answer me. So he wants God himself. Oh, that I had an indictment, you know. Oh, that I had an indictment written by my adversary. Surely, you know what? I would carry it on my shoulder. I would bind it on me like a crown. I would give him an account of all my steps. He wants God to come, that he could show God what is going on. You know? He is convinced. And in his conviction that he is innocent, is his conviction that it is God who is doing all of this to him. And this is where Job begins to overstep his bounds. Because now he's calling out God. He is telling God, okay, since you punish me, I have to be guilty of something. You can't show me where I'm guilty of. And that is where he overstepped his boundaries. Because no longer is he simply accepting it as a part of God's will and praying for God to come to his defense. He is challenging God to come and prove and justify himself to him, Job, a human. Of course, we know he would later repent of this. And verse 38 to 40, which is the conclusion of Job's arguments, he testifies again to his own integrity, calling curses upon himself if anybody could prove that he was indeed guilty. And his words ends there. Not because he is out of words, not because he dies, but because he has nothing else that he could argue. It is the end of his speech, and he will speak again, because at the end of Elihu's speech, which comes next in the written scripture, God will then speak. You have called me to appear. I have heard your wails. I have heard your crying. I have heard your complaints against me when I did you no wrong. And so I will come to talk to you. And it's interesting. It's interesting because I'm excited to see what God will say when God comes. Remember, God was proud of Job, which is why God which is why Job is going through all of this. And it made me wonder sometimes, if I find such good favor with God, you would think that if I find favor with God, that my life would become easy. But the minute I find favor with God, then the devil becomes an even stronger enemy, because he doesn't want me to align myself to God. It's interesting that it isn't until Job runs out of arguments that God shows up. That's a point I think we need to take. It is oftentimes, more often than not, when we feel that we are going through something that is unfair or unjust or too much for us, that we cry out to God. And we speak and we speak and we speak and we speak and we cry and we pray and we cry and we pray, and we don't shut up long enough to allow God an opportunity or a chance to speak. You see, we have to remember that it is called conversation for a reason. In a conversation, it is not one person talking, which is weird that I should say that, because right now, technically, how we are doing churches is one person talking. But even though I can't hear your response, I read your responses, because a conversation requires two people in an exchange. And even though Job from the onset have been asking God, he had been asking God to come and justify him, he didn't shut up long enough to hear what God had to say. And as soon as Job had shut up, his friends began to speak. And it isn't until everyone is completely out of words that God is going to show up. When we stop talking and finally begin to listen, we are better able to hear what God has to say. My mommy said something to me once as a child, and growing up, my family used to call me Piam Piam. We don't know what our Piam Piam, right? A Piam Piam is a bird that makes a lot of noise constantly. And apparently I used to like talking, and God knew why he made me a talker, because this would be my life. And my mother told me in my early teens, must be 13, 14, she says, the proportion of ears to mouth must be considered in the proportion of how much we talk versus how much we listen. In other words, you have two ears and one mouth, so listen twice as much as you speak. Good advice from my mommy. Yeah. And it's good advice to apply in terms of our relationships with others, and even more so with our relationship with God. Listen for God far more than you use your mouth to complain. And even when you praise God, listen for his response and his acceptance of your praise. Take more time to listen than to speak. Job and his friends, Job is officially out of words. And it is when he is out of words and is no longer trying to justify himself that God, that he has been waiting on all along, shows up and begins to speak. And it's almost as if God is saying, okay, you're done, because now that you are finished, you can allow me to be God. And I find that that's a beautiful thing for us to acknowledge this morning. It is only when we stop trying to be God and allow God to be God that we can see the presence of God. We always want to reason and rationalize things, and we always want the answers, and we always want to justify. Be still and know that he is God. Amen. We continue then with the profession of our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. As our Savior has taught us, so let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our suffrages. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance. Govern and uphold them now and always. Day by day we praise you. We bless you. We praise your name forever. Lord, keep us from all sin today. Have mercy on us, Lord. Have mercy. Lord, show us your love and mercy, for we put our trust in you. In you, Lord, is our hope, and we shall never hope in vain. Our first collect for this morning is the collect for the 14th Sunday after Pentecost, proper 18, and can be found on page 178 of our Books of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Grant us, O Lord, to trust in you with all our hearts, for as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A prayer for social justice. Grant, O God, that your holy and life-giving Spirit may so move every human heart that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatred cease, that our divisions being healed, we may live in justice and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. A collect for Fridays. Almighty God, whose most dear Son went not up to joy, but first he suffered pain, and entered not into glory before he was crucified, mercifully grant that we, walking in the way of the cross, may find it none other than the way of life and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. At this time, we pause to remember in our prayers and give God thanks for the gift of this new day of life. We remember in our prayers those who are celebrating birthdays today. Let me find my birthday list here. Today, Miss Melody Wagner, Miss Janelle Griffith, the Reverend Jerome Small, and Mr. Derek Jones are celebrating birthdays today. We want to wish you all a happy and blessed birthday, and we pray for God's continual blessing upon you. We continue to offer thanksgiving for those who are recovering from illness and surgery. We remember in our prayers Miss Judith, Miss Marcy, Miss Monica, Miss Margaret, Miss Ines, Miss Eileen, Miss Sylvia, Miss Harris, Miss Pauline, Miss Des, Miss Janice, Miss Marva, Miss Rose, Miss Jane, Miss Mary, Miss Jill, Miss Delverine, Miss Sonia, Miss Agnes, Miss Grace, and Miss Justine. We pray as well for Mr. Hilbert, Mr. Rudolph, Mr. Eliseo, Mr. Normando, Mr. Cecil, Mr. Larry, Mr. Finley, Mr. Rupert, and Mr. Linsford, Mr. James, Mr. Michael Samuels, Mr. Michael Soberanis, Mr. Alfred, Mr. Nicholas, Mr. Kenrick, Mr. Costa, Emery, Norman, Aaron, Jordan, and Mr. Leon. We pray God's blessing upon you for your continual health and protection. We remember in our prayers those who would have gone to their eternal rest. We remember families who are grieved or bereaved at this moment. And this morning we pray for the family of Mr. Andrew Flores, and we remember specifically his mom, Miss Venicia Caballero, and indeed the rest of his family this morning. We continue to pray for comfort for those who grieve and eternal rest for those who have died. We continue to pray for the protection of our loved ones who are far away from us. We remember our students, Tammy, Anwa, Karina, Courtney, and Ashley. We pray for wayfarers at sea, persons in the various forms of quarantine, persons stuck in countries other than their own due to the closure of borders, persons, we pray for traveling mercies for those who are traveling to or from our little jewel. We continue to pray for our loved ones in the military, remembering Emil and Jade at this time. We continue to pray for the enablement and protection of all medical professionals in the performance of their duties. We pray for Dr. Molina, Dr. Manzanero, Dr. Joseph. We continue to pray for Dr. Arana. We pray for Nurse Gill, Nurse Merlin, Nurse Aaron, Nurse Felicia, Nurse Alejandra, Nurse Stevens, all three of the Nurse Stevens that are in the medical system here in our community. We continue to pray for healing for those who are infected by COVID-19. We continue to pray for a cure or a vaccine for this disease. We pray for the containment and elimination of this COVID-19. We remember those who would have recently passed away due to COVID-19 infections. In remembering the deceased, we remember all those who lost their lives on September 11th in those terrorist attacks as well. We continue to pray for the combating of the economic fallout caused by this pandemic. We pray for the tourism, hospitality, and service industry. We pray for those in the aviation and transportation industry. We continue to pray for our public servants, our teachers. We continue to pray for those persons who are experiencing difficulties financially because of this pandemic and the effects that it has had on our economy overall. We continue to pray for the most vulnerable in our society, for the poor, the needy, the elderly, those with pre-existing health conditions. We pray for their safety and their protection during this time. We continue to pray for our security forces, those who are called to enforce the laws that govern us. We pray for the government and persons in positions of public trust and authority, our leadership that make decisions on our behalf. We continue to pray for the churches and the church leaders, those of you in the congregations, and we continue to ask God's blessing upon you as we continue to fellowship outside of our usual norm. We continue to pray for the private sector and all non-governmental organizations, and indeed all persons who are engaged in any way in trying to bring assistance to others during this time of pandemic. We pray for members of the international and the national community who presently suffer in any way, shape, or form from COVID-19. And thunder rumbling outside my window, we continue to pray for protection against natural disasters for ourselves and indeed for all persons worldwide. For the prayers of our hearts that our tongues cannot confess, we ask that Almighty God would hear our prayers. We conclude our intercessions by praying together. Almighty and eternal God, sanctify and govern our hearts and bodies in the ways of your law and the works of your commandments, that under your protection now and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By means of announcement, I want to thank you all for joining us for our services this morning and for the remainder of our service for the day. I remind you that at midday we have noonday devotions, followed by children's Bible minutes, and then evening prayer and compline to end off the day. In between evening prayer and compline, we will have prayer and praise party at 5:30, and we will be looking at patriotic music today. I'm having a bit of trouble finding some of the history behind the music. But guess what? Good music never hurt anybody, explanation or not. And since we are in the month of September, we'll be looking at some patriotic songs. So please join us for any or all of these broadcasts later on today. Let us conclude then with the prayer of dedication, followed by the grace, the dismissal, and our final hymn. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and to serve all persons, in the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. We are going to close off this morning with one called Let Your Kingdom Come. And I selected this one. I remember I was getting dressed on the morning of September 11th. I can't remember the year now, but I know it was before 2007. I was getting dressed to go to work as a teacher early in the morning with the TV on and looking at international news, which is something I did in the morning as I got ready. And I remember seeing the images of the planes crashing into the Twin Towers and hearing the story. And I remember the stillness, even though life continued around me as normal, people still having to go to work. The stillness, the solemnity, the solidarity, the grief that we all shared. It is interesting that it seems that it is only during moments of hardships that we are able to unite with each other. And I pray that as a people, as a nation, as a world, that it doesn't have to take moments of hardship and difficulties for us to unite, but that the knowledge that we are all children of God should be what unites us, not just when times are hard, but at all times. And so I selected this one entitled, Your Kingdom Come, because indeed, when the kingdom of God comes among us, it is then that we will truly live in unity, and it is then that we will truly live in peace. And as Christians, we are called to daily share more and more of the kingdom of God with those around us. I do pray you have a blessed and safe day. I look forward to seeing you later. Stay safe. Until soon. God bless. Bye for now.
Dying breath.
your kingdom come.